I propose to you the title Public Memory is Wisdom, and you will see why, indeed, why both, and why the painting. It's, of course, if some of you recognize, it's Rubens, the country we like, the author we like, and we'll see why would an artist make a painting like this later on. You will see how much of it can really Rubens is encoded in all our environment, specifically sometimes in works of art, which we tend to analyze formally, but then there's more to it. Now, this is me, in very brief. A geek, because once you really organize your life around your obsession, you must be a geek. This is what I produce, basically. That's my career. And then, all the rest you would like to know, as I may have mentioned already, is here on this website, because I saw it because it's also the philosophy of this conference, and probably even more than that. Then, of course, the production, because you don't get in front of the people without trying your best and trying to explain what it's all about. All that is on the website, and as we do, it's always really accessible, like the entire contents of the conference in the span of 17 years. We like this notion of culture as being free to use. Now, I go to the real authorities. One of the real authorities among the intellectuals of the world, I would say, was the famous, and you would recognize him, Bertrand Russell. Among many things, he proposed in his analysis of Western philosophy, one was there was a sentence which I liked so much that I proposed it to you as a start. To understand the actual world, as he continues to explain, is the beginning of wisdom. I was always wondering, you know, even in my lecturing, even in my museum work and so on, what's the starting point? And the starting point, however you're dealing with the past, is your present. Understanding the present world, actually, and helping the present people by using the past actually presents the main structure of your mission. Now, we have, as a world, undergone a very strange transition. From this ideological upheaval, from this time of hope and great expectations and change, to the reality which is rather banal and quite simple. The gesture is the same, the fervent attitude is there, the same, except that we thought at the beginning that we had some chances as a mankind. Now they seem to offer different chances. I leave it to you to judge. So, if I would paint the world, probably this would be the picture, the present. It's not very, very wise to start anything by saying ugly things about the present or proposing a dark picture, but I'm a risk. Of course, trying to shorten it and to compress it, I have proposed the name of this time of freedom of ours, and well, it may be exaggeration, but we are here to exaggerate sometimes, as we do in art, just to push people to understand or push them towards making some judgments and trying to profit from our proposals. And this is the list of our troubles. Since we don't have time, I propose you the list as it is. So, mock democracy if you agree. If you don't, wait for some more arguments. Then, media manipulation and fake news. Do we have to explain that? What did they tell us? That there could be a time which is called post-truth. time of lies, time of manipulation. How on earth would we actually be able to pronounce such a thing as a proposal for to name our time? And post fact, how can it enter public media? And it does, it's there. And they're trying to elaborate almost a theory about it. We have heard about hypocrisy like never before with politicians as crazy as they have never been, because seemingly they have an opportunity better than before. What to say about the first class slavery? That we didn't understand what financialization of the world can mean for the destiny of ordinary people. It operates commercially. And coming to that, you know, literacy as a sort of a phenomenon or a concept, you know. Actually, I think museums are about literacy. Literacy in all senses. So when people from a contemporary art museum come to me and say, what is our task? What would you say? I would say, it's covering the literacy, the visual literacy, because our cities are becoming ugly and trivial. So literacy would be probably your best task. Then we have so much insecurity and fear. We are living in polluted environments. We are living through, this is borrowed expression, through the amplification of the world. The world is not getting nicer, nor it stagnates. It's actually getting more ugly. And you know that. Now, I will say, why am I mentioning all this? Because you might think that it doesn't have to do anything with us. You are about science. You are about the physical principles. You are about high ground of the art history. So why would we be concerned with these problems, you know? Let others do it. No. No, because if we are the owners of public memory, if we are collective mind, you know, how can we forget about it? In brief, the museum is a punishment for not offering anything usable. If you offer usable things more than just plain amusement, you will have a full museum. You will have friends coming to share the costs that you are offering. And since we don't have any ideology anymore, we have opted for another ideology, so to say, which is greed. And we seem to propose it as a sort of a legitimate choice for the mankind. It cannot be. It's a vice. It's not neither strange nor wrong to make money, but it's wrong to make greed as your only goal. You don't construct anything upon vices. Most as it may seem, I will just say, look, what is the result? Pauperization of the world. We are inventing new classes, which is a precarious class, you know. We are actually in trouble, in deep trouble. So can museums do anything about it? Not much, but they can certainly help. Do they help? I would say not enough. So to speed up the chaos of these geopolitical reordering of the world and so on, we are the victims, you know. And how do I prove that? Because we have constant wars and conflicts. And of course, this is not the environment that we would wish for us, or indeed for our kids, for those that will come. So, what heritage do we leave them? Now, I just wanted to narrow the troubles to our own field. Has this been conceivable 10, 20, 30 years ago when we were hoping for a better world? Not really. You would not think that this would be possible. Because the next slide is showing the efficiency of it. And this is the world in which we live. Can we forget it? We shouldn't. Because it's literally us in this particular case. And don't imagine that museum in Rio burned because it was God's will. No, it was not well enough maintained. It was too poor. to maintain its systems of protection. Museums should be secure places. We never imagined that we should come into the situation when politicians will tell us, as I will tell you later on, that we are too expensive. The result, you see. So the culture is falling in priorities, our heritage is falling in priorities, so we have to be aware of that. It's like Orwell is actually fulfilling his prophecies. And indeed, if you know the situation, claim that we live in times of peace, but we actually live in times of war. So war is peace. Beautiful. Orwell, it was right. Now, we have all three people all over the world. Indeed, yes, if you just mention or just remember fiscal slavery and what I just said, so it means actually that freedom is slavery. And coming from the academic world and knowing something about it after three decades, almost spending over there, too, in museums, I can tell you, yes, the schools are worse, the universities are not as good as they used to be, and is it true that we are actually trying to propose ignorance and strength? You know, reducing our education, getting rid of social and humanist sciences and so on. I think we are dangerously doing just that. Now, what are the proofs? Oh, there are many. Of course, when given an opportunity, I can just prove that. But in some cases, just to illustrate a little bit of the point. The British Museum, read the inscription up there. First Shell, and then BP. I'm just mentioning two brand affairs that they had publicly with the big sponsors, inappropriate sponsors, sponsoring some conflictuous themes in the museum. And they were making their way to the Tin Tin. Well, of course, nobody is against partnerships and so on, but then you should be very careful and make delineation because we know our interests, and of course, why should we be ashamed? But then you cannot actually influence the structure nor the content of the exhibition, which did happen. So, is culture really that expensive? Something I've done well in my life, not many, but this one I did. I never allowed my students to walk away from the university with this question unanswered. Is culture expensive? No. And they knew why, and they knew how to explain. Now, this is, you recognize it, Tate's modern and its new extension. The price was circulated so much in the media that it doesn't matter, actually. It's not a matter of exact sum. But to illustrate the question, look at this marvel. So, military industry, industrial complex obviously has better arguments. Coming to the arguments, I'd like to show you something which was good enough for my students in different comparisons, but the same idea. How many tank modules could be built for this air carrier? One, two, three, four, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. From how many? What do you think? Take hold of this expensive. Oh my goodness! No, shall the taxpayers be able to pay it? And then the sponsors, then magnificent sponsors, by the way. How many? Many. My goodness. Yes. Still more, gentlemen. It's that many. That many. And do you need an air carrier? Well, you know, in a conversation over a dinner, a General X would probably tell you, well, that was, I think, more than we needed, but okay, you know, wouldn't harm our love to have one more. So, we need wisdom in our decisions, and we need to make the priority of values, you know, what are we after? Often in China, often enough, I know the country, but I think it can stand for the rest of the world in some way. Look at the Shanghai in 1997. That's like a village. 6 years later, this is Shanghai. Sorry, have a look. Good? Yes. Yes. Now, what am I trying to say? The growing so quickly, the world, not Shanghai, because Shanghai is a good illustration, it needs a lot of wisdom. You can't grow so quickly without being very wise what to do, because changes are quicker than your mind, than your social reaction, than your social contact, and you may get yourself into trouble. And about building sites, one of the world's biggest building sites, as we know, unfortunately, is the past. And that's dangerous. Should it be done? How far can we prevent it or influence it in a positive way, constructive way, making it sort of having certain purpose, noble purpose? But then, the trouble is there. What better task can you imagine for museums? Because museums are there to help, to oppose, to adapt, to help us to live through troubles. And if people think that you are concerned with their destiny, they will come to you and they will try to learn and make their situation better. Now, can heritage indeed or public memory, can it help? Depends upon the answer. How do you pose the answer? If you pose the answer like we did so many times in the history, do we need a better past? Well, of course, you know, using museums to create more of it, because museums often produce more and more past. And that, the rest of them not became the product. Or do we want better present, not to say future, using the past for the quality development? Because past is actually collective knowledge, collective experience. So, compressed, it may be even more than that, probably wisdom. Now, I need some help. There's already help over there. You know the gentleman probably, didn't meet him. Look what he said. All sciences are now under obligation to prepare the ground for the future task of philosopher, which is to solve the problem of value. He said, why philosophizing? And why just, you know, proposing ideas and discarding them and so on? We are talking about the problem of the value. In fact, about determining the true hierarchy of values, so that we can actually orientate ourselves, that we can make judgments, you know, that we can progress upon some analysis and some conclusions. I propose one thing. Just make a little change here and read it again. All sciences are now under the obligation to prepare the ground for the future task of the curator, heritage curator, which is to solve the problem of value and back in the world where we are all totally puzzled what to do to determine the true hierarchy of values. Your visitors are lost. Your users are uneasy about the world they are facing. Not that you will solve all the problems, but give them a hand. Try to orientate them. Tell them we understand you. And of course, you know, the problems are there to be solved. So, in some hypothetical future at least, we shall solve them. In brief, what was the postmodern syntax that anything goes? And we started to enjoy it because it was such a beautiful, eclectic world. Everything was possible. Unfortunately, it devolved into something which is horrible. Nothing matters. Trivial, banal society of eternal life shown. Shockingly enough, in the devalued world, museums are about values, if you agree with me. Museum is created, I propose this, where there is a dying heart of an identity, a value, a quality that deserves continuation. So we enter, we help, we try to sustain and serve as a sort of a pacemaker to the dying identity. Any museum should be about quality. I won't elaborate it. We start from life, as Bertrand Russell was proposing. And then we go to knowledge. Knowledge society, the hell, we are living in the largest society, and how deep in trouble we are. Because knowledge can be used for anything. We need more than knowledge. We need quality knowledge, responsible knowledge, compressed knowledge, sedimented with some help of people, of science, and people of contemplation, wisdom. And then to turn it into some virtues by which we can live a decent life, a noble human condition, not just any. So, which tells us, in fact, if you are radical, as I would like to have you, you are about values and quality. You are, in fact, value system management or maintenance business. Because it's a very serious job. It's not just being scientist and knowing everything about anything or small detail of the world. Sometimes probably useless. Five main reasons for convergence of public memory institutions and probably, again, forming a profession. We have the same concept, which is heritage, which is collective transfer of experience. Working process is the same. Collecting care and communication. Try to break it down is the same for archive, for the library, and for the museum. You know, the differences are just 10%, 5%, whatever. It's not serious. So, ICT, we use the same technology to express ourselves. The users are the same necessarily. Oops. And then also the vision. Participation in the social contract. I think I'm heading towards the end. We won't go into the details, but just see how world can be different if you just say, we are about museums, then it's just one circle. And then if you say, we are about heritage, panorama. So how do we do it? Well, it can be probably the subject of our next lecture with some new answers, but I suppose it won't happen. So, society is actually depending upon professions. But there's one profession missing, I'll tell you. Very simplified version. The sphere of unknown. So, we have priests to shoot us down. And there's social chaos as threatening possibility. Then we have politicians. Then there's this threat of injustice. We have law practitioners. Diseases and so on, we have doctors, of course. There's insecurity, we have engineers, my goodness, professions are there to save us. We have scientists and educationalists to fight the ignorance. But oblivion and involution are something that we need a profession for. Public memory, heritage, curators. As a profession, as a whole, if possible. This is how society defends itself. And you will probably notice that we have been witnessing the process of destruction or degradation of professions because it is, part of the possible trouble. The position of institutions, I will just say we are mediators. Sorry to be too quick. It was not meant to be very professorial. Lecture, so we go quickly through it. And as I'm advocating some real science of our profession, you will see that we move from institution to system, from practice to strategy, from theory to real science. Any profession has a science behind it. So if we want to be a profession, we need to have a science. In brief, knowledge becomes wisdom, and we are not the scribes of the society, but probably partners to it, meaning we take part in decisions. So, what are we not curious for? I hope I have this answer. You are here to do good. What others are doing here, I wouldn't know. Again, something I have borrowed from Winston Hugh Auden. He was asked, what are the poets for? And I think it's just the same answer, which fits us as well. We are here to do good. We're coming back to close the circle, and we're coming back to Rubens. All I can say is, look at the perfect description of a museum. You have collective experience. You have an eager young to take it, because look at his eyes. And you have the process. This is the shortest description of the process in public memory institutions, be them museums or others. I will skip the explanation because I did offer it, because we are about harmonious development, and without any wisdom, you don't do it, because you can't. Knowledge is not enough. I end up by proposing the formula again. Why not, you know, play? Because, as you see, Einstein was also playing. Wisdom is knowledge multiplied by love squared. Any of communicators here in the audience know that if you don't love your audience, you will never communicate anything. And they have to love you to learn. Goethe. This, I think, is the last. By knowledge, one can manage corporation. To manage society, one needs wisdom. Said by an unknown crowd. And the last message, I think, a good museum is like a good brain. Reliable, amusing, and useful. Can you cover that? You use the bridges between the two parts. As many as you have them, the better. Oops. Sorry, I did say last, but benchmarking is important. Tracking the success, I think, is actually about being well aware of what's going on and trying to inspire us. So this is what we do here. This is my last message to you. The world, which is peace, because when peace is there, anything else is possible and must be possible, because, you know, we know our job. Thank you.